The next item of business is a debate on motions 13154 and 13155 in the name of John Swinney on appointment of Scottish Minister and appointment of Junior Scottish Minister. Can I remind members that under Rule 11.3.1 of Standing Orders, the question on these motions will be put immediately after the debate, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on John Swinney to speak to and move the motion. Up to 12 minutes, First Minister.
Presiding Officer, it is with great pleasure that I rise to move the motion in my name that Kate Forbes be appointed as a Scottish Minister and that Ivan McKee be appointed as a Scottish Junior Minister. In doing so, let me set out the approach my ministerial team will take. When I accepted this Chamber's nomination for First Minister, I made it clear that I would be a First Minister for all of Scotland. Governments across the world are facing substantial challenges, and given those challenges, I believe, where possible, the best approach is to build consensus within our Parliament. In recent days, I have also spoken of the political ground which my party and my government will occupy, and that is firmly in the mainstream moderate centre, left of centre tradition. I believe this is where most people in Scotland want us to be, and it therefore offers a sound starting point for that consensus building. And I will work with colleagues across the Parliamentary Chamber to secure agreement where we can on the issues that matter to the people of our country. For our colleagues in the Scottish Green Party in particular, with whom we have shared a partnership government in recent years, I hope we will be able to find common ground, albeit without a formal agreement in place. In appointing my ministerial team, I have made clear to all of my ministers the need to do everything in our power to help bring about as much agreement as possible in this Parliament. Of course, there will be occasions when it is not possible to build consensus or where ideas come forward from parties who have alternative but equally legitimate policy agendas, but we quite simply cannot reach points of agreement. In both instances, we will listen and we will consider. If it is not possible to reach agreement, and of course in any vibrant democracy, argument is essential, I reiterate for my part that our engagement with Parliament will be undertaken with courtesy and respect. My ministerial team will respect different opinions and move forward in the manner I believe the people who sent us here want us to do, and that is to ensure that we engage constructively with other parties and listen carefully to their ideas. It is, of course, however, the role of opposition to oppose. But equally, I will never shy away from stating the government's record and achievements in the steps that we have taken. In our mission to eradicate child poverty, we are lifting an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty. Since 2007, when this government came to office, GDP per head has grown more quickly in Scotland than in the rest of the UK as a whole. Productivity has also grown faster. Through measures such as removing peak rail fares and extending bus travel to under 22-year-olds, we are actively helping with the cost of living as it affects individuals in our society. In our most precious public service, the National Health Service, we have the best performing core A&E units in the United Kingdom. Prescriptions are free, while the cost continues to rise south of the border. Attainment is at a record high, and record numbers of students from deprived backgrounds are going to university. Significant progress has also been made to tackle the climate emergency. But we do know that on climate change and other policy areas, more needs to be done. With my new ministerial team, Presiding Officer, we will work for every hour of every day to tackle the challenges head on and to build a better Scotland. Before I turn to today's appointments, let me pay tribute to the ministers who are today leaving government. Joe Fitzpatrick has been a hard-working Minister for Local Government Empowerment and Planning, leading on the Scottish Government's relationship with our partners in local government and driving forward our ambition to improve the efficiency of the planning system. Emma Roddick has served well as Minister for Equalities, Migration and Human Rights. She has worked hard to build a better Scotland for minority groups and for refugees. And George Adam has been a tireless Minister for Parliamentary Business. His role of liaising with other parties has always been performed with good humour and professionalism, and he has been absolutely integral to the structuring of constructive relationships between the Scottish National Party and the Green Party in the course of our partnership agreement. So I welcome and thank each of the ministers for their service to the Scottish Government. I also pay tribute to the departing First Minister who left office on Tuesday. I look forward to Hamza Yousaf's wise counsel from the back bench, as well as his enthusiastic applause for all that I am saying. All of those departing government leave with my sincere thanks and I'm sure the best wishes of the whole parliamentary chamber. The team that I have assembled represents... The team that I have assembled represents the most talented and capable public servants that the Scottish National Party Government wishes to offer to the people of Scotland and to this Parliament. Firstly, I am delighted that Kate Forbes has accepted the role of Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for the Economy and for the Gaelic language and for Scotland's languages. Kate Forbes has made a significant contribution to this parliamentary chamber, and her daughter appears to be making a significant contribution from the gallery as well. Kate Forbes has held an Kate Forbes is held in extremely high regard in Scotland's business community and has a strong track record of championing the issues that relate to the success of the Scottish economy, and indeed this morning has been engaged in detailed discussions with the business community on the priorities that the government will take forward. As Scotland continues to be buffeted by the effects of Westminster austerity and Brexit, it is more important than ever that we use every lever at our disposal to harness Scotland's economic strengths. Kate Forbes will play a key role in driving forward that agenda. In doing so, she will ensure that we deliver growth for a purpose. It must be growth that is sustainable, that benefits everyone, and that improves our public services. She will take on the responsibility for Scotland's languages and for one of Scotland's most cherished assets, the Gaelic language. And I look forward to demonstrating our support to the Gaelic language when I attend the parliamentary reception this evening to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the foundation of Saul Morostig, the Gaelic College in Skye, in the constituency of the Deputy First Minister. I'm also pleased that Ivan McKee returns to government. With his significant professional and political experience, Ivan McKee will make a formidable Minister for Public Finance in a role that requires forensic attention to detail. Alongside Kate Forbes and Ivan McKee's appointments, there are some other changes in the ministerial team. Cocab Stewart becomes Minister for Equalities, an issue on which she has campaigned her entire adult life. Jamie Hepburn becomes the new Minister for Parliamentary Business. I know that Jamie Hepburn has warm relationships with MSPs from across the political spectrum, and combined with his political abilities, there is no one better suited to this key role, a role which is even more important in minority government, and one which will report directly to me, recognising the significance of parliamentary relationships. Angus Robertson will be taking forward our work across culture, external affairs and the Constitution. Christina McKelvey, in her role as Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy, will now report directly to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, ensuring the closest possible working with our other public health priorities. Tom Arthur, who has been a highly effective public finance minister, will become the new Minister for Employment and Investment. And finally, I would like to pay particular tribute to the former Deputy First Minister, my friend Shona Robertson. In stepping back as Deputy First Minister, as I form a government, Shona Robertson has displayed the typical selflessness and team spirit that she has demonstrated throughout her many years in government. Nobody except those who have served as a finance secretary understands the extraordinary effort that is required to steer a budget through Parliament. I'm therefore delighted that Shona Robertson has accepted my invitation to continue as Finance Secretary, a role which she has accomplished with tremendous success. A number of ministers remain in post. They are the best people for their roles and they will work closely with other new colleagues. Let me finish, Presiding Officer, by pledging to the people of Scotland what they can expect from my ministerial team. The aim of my government will be to help people and their families get on in life, to live happier, healthier lives, to feel secure, and with that security feel a sense of possibility and opportunity. That ambition should not just be for a minority or even a majority for people, but for everyone. which is why the goal of eradicating child poverty is so close to my heart and which will be central to the direction of my government. And to Scotland's business community, we promise to do everything we can to help them not just survive these difficult times, but to thrive. On constitutional change, everyone in this chamber should remember that there is a majority in this Parliament for independence. That is the result of a democratic choice made by the people of Scotland. Now, I know that opposition members may, or some opposition members may not like that choice, but it is frankly odd that some so often disregard that choice. More than that, it is disrespectful to the people who put us here to disregard that choice. Perhaps, Presiding Officer, this new chapter in our democracy will bring some reflection on that important point. Those of us who believe in independence do so because we believe, with the powers of a normal independent country, we can collectively as a nation build a wealthier, fairer country. So we will continue to make the case, in line with the mandate we have received, for the powers we need to make the most of the talents of all of our people. We will do everything we can within the current powers. We will engage with and listen to Scotland's people, our civic organisations and our businesses. And we will work with members of the Scottish Parliament across the chamber to deliver a better Scotland, to drive sustainable economic growth, to deliver better public services, and to eradicate once and for all the curse of child poverty. For me, all these things are interlinked. Public services can only be properly funded when we have a strong economy. An economy can only be strong when every citizen is reaching their full potential. A fairer economy is the bedrock of a healthier, happier population. I and my ministerial team will focus on all of those efforts in the service of the people of Scotland, and I move the motions in my name.
Thank you. And I now call on Megan Gallagher, up to 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, we were promised fresh leadership by John Swinney, but all we got from his much-talked-up cabinet reshuffle was Humza Yousaf's cabinet with a different figurehead. They couldn't even be bothered to shuffle around portfolios in any major way. We were promised that there would be a streamlined cabinet with less people in it. Yet instead, his cabinet is even larger than it was under his predecessor, costing taxpayers tens of thousands of pounds more. We were promised by this First Minister that he would reach out to other parties and deliver a new style of politics. However, as we saw from First Minister's questions today, that it was this SNP government who will continue to deflect and obfuscate instead of being upfront and honest. For all John Swinney talks about leading a new or revitalised government, the last couple of days have shown that this remains the same old SNP government that Scotland has suffered under for the last 17 years. Yet, while the government has remained the same, Parliament has changed. The SNP no longer command a majority of this chamber. They have ended their deal with the Greens. And while we have welcomed the end of the Bute House Agreement, it has consequences for this government. The SNP must now change its approach and reach out. They must build consensus and collaborate. Otherwise, they will be blocked from taking forward the agenda. That is why we will not support the government's appointments today. And this is not a personal criticism for any of the individuals who are up for approval today. Instead, we are putting down a marker that this government must change its approach. The Scottish Conservatives will take every opportunity to oppose this SNP government and its obsession with independence. But this does not mean that we are not above working with other parties in this Parliament to deliver on the real priorities of the Scottish people. This is now a Parliament of minorities, and the SNP must now recognise this. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. On behalf of Scottish Labour, can I welcome colleagues who are new to their roles on the government benches? And I'd also like to thank those who are leaving office for their public service over their time. But, Presiding Officer, the announcement of this continuity cabinet is just another example of the SNP putting its own party interest before the country's interest. We recognise that those ministers who will be appointed today and will be charged with both responsibility and opportunity, which I hope they will grasp, but I fear the ambition to work in Scotland's best interests is lacking in this government. After 17 years of failure, every single institution in Scotland is weaker, and those responsible still remain at the heart of government. Our NHS is in chaos, 1 in 6 Scots on waiting lists. Our economy is stalling, slow growth, low pay persists. And our schools, they now face deep teacher number cuts while violence in the classroom soars and the attainment gap persists. Now more than ever, Scotland needs a government that has fresh ideas, is focused on the tasks at hand. But all this is a continuity cabinet that cannot be trusted to fix the chaos and the instability that they created. We need a government that can rise to the crisis in our public service. But today, we're just offered more of the same. Because this is the same SNP government that has delivered a record of failure across our public services. And while cabinet reshuffle has been a perfect example of the First Minister putting the management of the SNP before the interests of Scotland, elsewhere, it is clear just how much the SNP has downgraded the ambitions for Scotland. As the government axes the NHS Recovery Minister, waiting lists have got longer, not shorter. Over 820,000 Scots stuck on those waiting lists. While they abolish a planning minister, homelessness hits record levels, 10,000 children living in temporary accommodation. And as thousands of businesses go to the wall and this government squanders the opportunities of a green transition, ministers for the just transition, fair work and innovation and trade, all scrapped. After 17 years of failure, this reshuffle is confirmation of what many Scots have felt for years. The ambition has been downgraded, the public services abandoned, and the most vulnerable are being asked to pay the price for the SNP chaos and incompetence. Under the SNP, the most vulnerable in our society are now being forced to pick up the tab for those SNP failures. The public don't believe that continuity will cut it, but for this government, that seems to be their highest ambition. Because now more than ever, our country needs credible, effective leadership. People need a government on their side, focused on creating jobs, lowering bills. They need a government that will renew, repair our NHS, put patients and staff first. A government that will invest in Scotland's potential and build a better nation. So while I wish genuinely all the ministers who are appointed today well, I fear the task ahead is beyond them, because Scotland is crying out for change, and it's clear that a tired government can't deliver it.
Thank you, and I now call on Ross Grier, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by thanking George Adam, Joe Fitzpatrick and Emma Roddick for their contribution to government. It was a privilege to work with them through the Bute House Agreement, and they're all champions of a fairer, more equal Scotland. Presiding Officer, the Act which established this Parliament gives the First Minister the responsibility of nominating those he wishes to serve as Scottish Ministers. It gives Parliament the responsibility to decide on the suitability of those candidates. John Swinney knows the esteem that I hold him in, but today he's asking me and other members of this Parliament who are LGBT to appoint to the second highest office in this country an individual who believes it was wrong that Parliament granted us the same legal rights as everyone else 10 years ago. I cannot, the Scottish Greens cannot, support the appointment of someone who fundamentally does not believe that everyone in Scotland is equal, worthy of equal rights and respect under the law. We cannot support the appointment of someone who believes not only that equal marriage is wrong, but also children being born outside of marriage. So we will oppose the appointment of Kate Forbes for Deputy First Minister. I'm a man of deep Christian faith, but I do not hold the same views as Kate has set out. That statement certainly applies to me, but it wasn't me who said it. It was John Swinney. Last year, the now First Minister said that Kate Forbes was entitled to her views, but that others are entitled to decide if someone who holds those views would be an appropriate individual to be First Minister. As Mr Swinney said then, this is not about whether a person holds to a particular faith. My belief in the good news brought by Jesus Christ is something I share with Mr Swinney and Ms Forbes, and in that we share something far more important than party affiliation or political ideology. Faith is not the issue here. The issue is that I'm being asked to vote for someone who thinks there's something wrong with me. Not because of any views I hold, but simply because of who I am. I will not do that, and the Scottish Greens will not do that. Yesterday, Kate Forbes was given the opportunity to reassure LGBT people in a question asked by ITV News. She did not. The First Minister had to step in just to say the word LGBT. This month, we celebrate 25 years of this Parliament. There's much to celebrate, especially in all the ways in which Scotland has become a more equal place as a result of devolution. But in the last few years, it feels for the first time like we are going backwards. Scotland is, in many ways, a harder place to be LGBT today than it was 5 years ago. My lapel pin was given to me by the Time for Inclusive Education campaign. Their work delivered LGBTQ inclusive education in our schools, and it's a sad reflection of where Scottish politics is now that if the TAI campaign were launched today rather than a decade ago, I do not think it would succeed. The existence of LGBTQ people, especially queer young people, has been called into question in a way many of us hoped was consigned to history. First Minister, many LGBTQ Scots are afraid today. I know that's not your intention, and it's certainly not the intention of Kate Forbes, but it is the reality. It was the reality before Kate Forbes' nomination for Deputy First Minister. But the First Minister must acknowledge that this nomination has heightened that fear. And if he doesn't wish to hear it from me, he could listen to the many LGBTQ members of the Scottish National Party who expressed their fear and alarm yesterday. Before I close, Presiding Officer, I want to address those who have highlighted that the Scottish Greens have worked with Kate Forbes previously. That's true. There are issues that we progressed together that I'm proud of, like the agreement to begin trials of a four-day working week in the public sector. That was all before the SNP leadership election last year, in which these deeply hurtful positions were made known. It would have been wrong to presume Kate Forbes' views simply because the church she is a member of. Ian Blackford is a fine example of a Free Church member and an elected representative who played a key role in advancing equal marriage rights across these islands. He also supported John Swinney last year when he questioned Ms Forbes' suitability for high office. There is not a credible argument for someone being an unsuitable First Minister, but a perfectly suitable deputy. I know that John Swinney considers me and all LGBT members of this Parliament to be equal. I know that he shares in the joy felt by every LGBT person in Scotland who has used the marriage right that this Parliament gave them, including members of this Parliament. But today the First Minister is asking us to appoint as his deputy someone who does not share in that joy, who does not think we are deserving of equality under the law, who thinks there's something wrong with us. I cannot, the Scottish Greens cannot do that, but I want to hear him tell me why I should.
Thank you, and I now call on Willie Rennie.
The First Minister's trying to adopt a new approach. You'll forgive me for being a little bit sceptical, because we have been here before, but we want to try and meet him on those terms. We'll start that today. We won't block the appointment of Kate Forbes. We may have difference of views on equalities, but Kate Forbes does deserve a chance to govern, putting those views to one side. But if he doesn't mind, if the First Minister, I have some advice on developing relationships across the chamber. I don't expect him to stop believing in independence, but he must realise that the more he uses his position and that of the government to push independence, the more difficult it is for us to reach across that constitutional divide to work in partnership. My second piece of advice is to get out of the comfort zone. At least in the first instance, try a bit harder to answer the question properly, if not for MSPs, then for the public. When people are suffering, they genuinely don't want to hear that we're better than Westminster or even Wales. Thirdly, please stop saying that ministers are considering a proposal when it's patently obvious that they are not. For me, I have an example very close to home, and it's affected me deeply. The flood victims in Cooper feel insulted that they have been strung along with the possibility of financial support similar to that received in Angus. I trusted ministers when they told me they were seriously considering that. It will take a lot to convince me again. I want to get things done for my constituents. Liberal Democrats have crossed the constitutional divide before on the budget in 2021 and others, and just more recently on the Children Care and Justice Bill. And if getting things done means working with ministers, we'll do just that. Now, I hope that Emma Roddick, Joe Fitzpatrick and George Adam look back on their time in office with a sense of pride. Nevertheless, it must be difficult to return to the back benches. But at least we will have more speeches about the great city of Paisley to look forward to once again. I hope the Chamber will permit me to have some personal satisfaction that Jamie Hepburn is free. He has been released from that heavy burden, churning out those dreaded independence papers in the bowels of St Andrew's House. Solidarity with the Cumbernauld one. Look at him. The smile on his face, it's a joy to behold, isn't it? And he is climbing the ministerial ladder, as I had planned. My campaign has been so successful that I'm beginning to wonder whether I'm actually pulling the strings of our new First Minister. Now, I yield to no one in my great admiration of Jamie Hepburn, but I must admit I am slightly nervous that he is to move from the position of the great divider as the Independence Minister to the great healer as the Minister for Parliamentary Business. And I'm sure we are all looking forward to his joint peace-building initiative, bringing together the likes of Stephen Kerr, Fergus Ewing, Jackie Bailey and Patrick Harvey. I wish him well.
Thank you, and I call on the First Minister to wind up. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Let me respond to a number of the points. I won't respond to all of the points that have been made in the Chamber, but let me respond to a number of them, because there are serious and important points that have been made by all colleagues. I genuinely embark on my term as First Minister with a desire to see this institution work more collaboratively than it is currently working. And I accept, and I've accepted this publicly, that our politics are polarised today, and there has to be effective leadership to improve that situation. It's very much the heart of some of the comments that Megan Gallagher made in her speech. And I have pledged to give that leadership on behalf of the Scottish Government and to contribute to ensuring that we can arrive at agreements within our Parliament that will improve the lives of people in Scotland and ensure people in Scotland can have more confidence about their future in this country, given the enormous pressures and challenges with which people wrestle at this moment. Martin Whitfield made a number of remarks about the record of the government. And when I stood down as Deputy First Minister, my last speech from this place, I said that I was going to give some advice to the opposition, which was that I didn't think it was a particularly strong narrative to say to people that everything in Scotland is today awful. And I say that genuinely because I went through a period of saying that in the run-up to the 2003 election when I was leader of the SNP. Yeah. I made an argument about the fact that everything was absolutely awful and it didn't actually do us any good electorally. So I offer that from a sage election winner. I offer that friendly advice to Mr Whitfield with the generosity of spirit that will, for which I will be renowned in the years to come. On Willie Rennie's contribution, I welcome the willingness of the Liberal Democrats to enable the appointments to be made today, and I recognise the rationale and the motivation for doing that, to create perhaps some space for us as a Parliament to progress from where we are today, to find areas of agreement and common purpose. Mr Rennie encouraged me to be a bit more explicit about answering questions, and I actually was trying to do that at First Minister's question time today. I think I maybe startled a few people with some of my answers about some of the challenges that we face. Although I have conceded to the presiding officer over lunchtime that they were perhaps a bit on the lengthy side of things. Yeah, I see the deputy presiding officer is gesticulating to me about the length of the answer, so I will do my best, presiding officer. But Mr Rennie makes a substantive point about the issues that can be achieved when there is substantial engagement between members of Parliament. Natalie Dawn, the Children's Minister, has worked very hard to work with colleagues across the Chamber to get the Children's Care and Justice Bill into a stronger position than it is in today than it was when the government introduced it. And I acknowledge that some of that strengthening has been because of opposition contribution to the debate and response from the government, which the government originally wasn't prepared to offer. So I think the point that Willie Rennie makes is an important point about how we can actually find some common ground. Without disclosing the contents of a private conversation, I did say to Mr Rennie in the corridor some months ago that I had listened to him on the radio and found myself thinking he does make a fair point about the flooding issue in Cooper. So let me take Mr Rennie's issue away and see what I can do about that particular issue, because I did think he made a fair point. If Mr Rennie believes that he has liberated Jamie Hepburn from a heavy burden, I'm afraid to tell Mr Rennie he is wrong on that one. There is a straight answer to a question, because I fear for the burdens that Jamie Hepburn is going to have to carry in the period going forward. Now, lastly, can I come to the contribution from Ross Grier? And Ross Grier set out, an understandably, a deeply personal perspective, a personal perspective for him, but also a perspective that is shared by his colleagues. And I understand that. And I think Ross Grier and his colleagues in the Green Party know that I respect the issues and considerations and perspectives that they have. What I was trying to say to Patrick Harvey in my question, in my response to his question at First Minister's questions some time ago, is that the country I want to lead, well, the country I lead actually today, is a modern, diverse, dynamic society. I recognise that. My whole government recognises that. All of its members recognise that. And we want to keep it that way. That's what we are committed to doing. We want to make sure that those values of diversity that have been at the heart of the journey of this Parliament over so many years are protected and enhanced as we move forward as a country together. Because when I say to the country, as I did on Tuesday, standing here, that I offer myself as the First Minister for everybody in Scotland, I cannot convey adequately or strongly enough that I mean absolutely everybody. I want every single person in our society to feel they are at home and at peace in our society. And I come to these conclusions actually from some of the motivations that Mr Grier has talked about as well. I come to them from a very deep Christian faith. I believe in that nothing can separate us from the love of God. That is the foundation of who I am. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, and we are equal in the eyes of God, every one of us. And I hope those comments, which are more forthright comments about faith than I have ever uttered in my 45 years in politics, will perhaps illustrate to Parliament the magnitude of the seriousness with which I take the issues that Mr Grier puts to me, and also the seriousness with which I embark on my office as First Minister to make sure that the government I lead, the participants of all of my colleagues in that government, are undertaken in a fashion that ensures that everybody in Scotland feels that their government is with them, is protecting them, is assuring them, is making them feel safe, and will always be on their side. And that's what I offer the people of Scotland when I say I will be the First Minister for everybody in our country.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on appointment of Scottish ministers and junior Scottish ministers. There are two questions to be put. The first question is that motion 13154 in the name of John Swinney on appointment of Scottish minister be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.